Welcome all to this fifth lecture of Principles of Statistics. In the last lecture, we finished by introducing the section on the law of large numbers and the central limit theorem, and we'll continue and finish this section today, and we'll start the consistency of MLEs. So we start with the law of large numbers, and this is going to be the strong law of large numbers. So we can start now. Theorem one, maybe not. Theorem one. So this is the strong law of large numbers. So LLN, as the usual abbreviation. So then, you know, let's start with the random variables. So let x1, x2, and so on be a sequence of random variables that are going to be IID copies of another one, x distributed according to some distribution capital P on RD. So we keep working in the multidimensional setting. And, you know, the assumption that we're going to need for this theorem is one that you should be sort of familiar with, and it's just that the norm of the random vector is finite. Yeah. So then if we have this, we get the following. So the so-called sample mean, which is defined as 1 over n, the sum of the observations up until n. So this guy is going to converge to the expectation, okay? And how does it do it? Well, it does it almost surely, okay? And this is, of course, as n goes to infinity, okay? Okay, and this is, of course, by the way, the almost sure convergence is under the PR measure that we introduced in the last lecture, okay? So this, this infinite product measure. Okay, so this is just the, you know, the usual result. We're not going to prove this strong law of large numbers, but let me just remark how to prove it in a much simpler case. So the weak law of large numbers, which I remind you that it's basically as above, but convergence in distribution, or well, in this case, in probability, is the same, right? By the first bit of Slutsky's lemma or theorem. So convergence in probability. So the weak law of large numbers follows immediately from something that you should be familiar with, which is Chebyshev's inequality. Well, this is for one dimension, yeah? From Chebyshev's inequality. This is, of course, for D equal one, yeah? So we want to prove convergence in probability. So let's look at then the probability under this PR of the xn to whatever value we wanted to converge to, right? So in this case, this guy. And so we want to look at the probability of this guy being larger than epsilon, right? Or its absolute value. Yeah? So then we apply Chebyshev here, and this gives us the variance. So the variance of this quantity, this, you know, xn bar minus this guy, and this divided by epsilon squared, right? So this is just the usual thing. And then, you know, the variance of this absolute value is just the variance of the value inside it. And, you know, by the usual computations of the variance, this is going to be simply the, so this is actually equal then. So this is going to be equal to the variance of this x divided by n epsilon squared. Yeah? And this, of course, converges to zero as n goes to infinity if the variance of x is finite. Yeah, so that's actually an assumption for this weak law of large numbers, or yeah, at least for this version of it. Yeah. Okay, so that should be sort of clear. And let me just check. Yes, it's all good. So then, you know, as I just said, the strong law of large numbers is harder to prove. Yeah. And I think you may see a proof of it in probability measure. I'm not sure. The strong law of large numbers is harder to prove. Yeah. Okay. So that was simple stuff. Let's move on then to the central limit theorem, which is a stronger sort of result than the law of large numbers. And for that, let me introduce some concepts from multivariate analysis. So these are the following, and they pertain basically normal distributions. So let's recall the following. So we have that X follows a multivariate normal distribution, which, you know, can also, well, I guess more precisely, it's written as this, so nd, and then, you know, once we have the notation, we can specify the mean and the covariance matrix. So this is with mean mu, that of course belongs to Rd, and covariance matrix capital sigma. This of course, you know, belongs to D times D, but it has to be, you know, covariance matrix. So this is non-negative definite. And so we say this if alpha transpose of this being a vector times, well, let me just write it on the next line. So alpha, so if we multiply any vector by this capital X, so this is just a linear form, then this follows a one-dimensional normal distribution with this mean and this variance. Yeah? And this is for all, it has to be for all alpha, so for all vector in Rd. Yeah. Okay, so that's simple. So this is saying what I just said, so that you get, you know, that all the linear forms will be univariate normal with such parameters. And so now you'll say, well, okay, but what about the density? Well, okay, so if we have that this guy is non-singular, then maybe X has density, or probability, okay, so X has density, PDF, given by following function. So we have this fx, we could, you know, parameterize by mu and sigma if you like, but we can also just ignore that, omit that. So we get a 2 pi to the d halves, so that's the usual quantity, same here, the absolute value of the determinant of this capital sigma, and then the exponential following quantity, which is x minus the mean transpose sigma to the minus one, because it's invertible, and then x minus mu. Yep. Okay, and this is of course for all x in Rd. Okay, right, simple stuff. I'm just reminding you these things, and more generally, what we get as a property is that generally, okay, more generally, if we have a matrix, you know, from say K to D, and we have a vector in RK, then, you know, affine transformations of this capital X by these two quantities are going to still be normally distributed with the following sort of characteristics. So this is now A mu plus B and A capital sigma A transpose. Yeah. Okay. And furthermore, we can give one more property. So furthermore, if we sort of have a sequence of random matrices, so if a n converges to a, you know, in probability as in the, so I think this was the last bit of Slutsky's lemma, so that's, so in proposition one, and I think three, maybe D could be. So if we have that, and also we have a sequence of random variables that converges in distribution to capital X, then we get just what you're probably expecting, which is that if you take the product of these guys, then this will converge, you know, in distribution to A times X. Yeah. And of course, these capital A's could be just as before, so dimension K times D. Yeah. Okay. Okay, capital X, by the way. Okay, so this is distributed according to a normal distribution with K in this case. That'd be right. What am I saying here? So this would be then just distributed according to, okay, let me just write this. So A mu, yes, of course. A capital sigma, A transpose. Okay, so this is just, yeah, the usual thing. Yeah. Okay. So maybe just one more comment. Doesn't fit there, so I guess remark, capital sigma being diagonal means that the components of capital X are independent. Yeah? Okay. Okay, so now we're ready to introduce the multivariate central limit theorem. So this is theorem two. So theorem two, the CLT, in this case, multivariate. So let again have a sequence of random variables that are IID copies of, some capital X that is distributed according to some distribution capital B, such that we have that the, so what we want now, and this is, well, this by the way still on RD, of course, on RD, such that, well, now we need a second moment, okay? So we're going to need basically that the, rather than just the norm, the X is the norm squared, yeah, that's fine. Okay, so then we get, the usual statement, which is saying that if we take the quantity from the law of large numbers, so that's the centered, well that's not even centered, but not necessarily centered, but it's just this, it's the sample mean that we center it around, the limiting value that we would expect because we have second moment and that implies a first moment. So then if we rescale this guy by square root of n, what we get is that it converges in distribution to a normal distribution, distribution with, in this case, dimension d and mean zero. and covariance given by this capital sigma. Okay, so that should be, capital sigma is not really defined here, so this should be the covariance of X. Covariance matrix of X. Yeah. Okay. Because capital X doesn't need to be the previous capital X, which was a normal distribution. Okay, so maybe, before I talk about the central limit theorem, let me make a remark. So, this remark, introduce a corollary. The central limit theorem, you know, we just stated it in terms of distribution, while the law of large numbers was stronger in that it was in terms of, well, it was in the sense of probability or even almost sure convergence. So the central limit theorem does not hold in distribution, in probability, and of course even less so in almost sure. Yeah. But by Prokhorov's theorem, so this is, it could be the last part of proposition one, I seem to remember. So by Prokhorov's theorem, we get the following corollary. So under the assumptions, or assumption probably, setting an assumption. Assumption of theorem two, or you know, the central limit theorem that we had there. We have that, you know, it may not be that this quantity, you know, this guy, when rescaled by n, converges in probability, but what we can say is that actually it is bounded in probability. Okay. So the 1 over root of n, you know, you could take it to the left hand side, the square root of n, and just say that it is a bounded random variable in probability. Okay. Okay, so that's the corollary, and so then what I'm going to, I guess, remark here is the meaning of these two results, and maybe I will talk about it in reverse order, because corollary one, of course, has to be weaker than the theorem, so I'll start from weak to strong, and so remark, well, I guess in conclusion, right, from two things, is that, you know, what this is really, really telling us is that the random fluctuations or the stochastic fluctuations of this guy that we started looking at in the law of large numbers are of order 1 over square root of n, right? And, you know, this is really what corollary 1 is telling us, but now the central limit theorem is actually telling us exactly how these are going to be distributed, at least, you know, as we get more and more data, okay? So the, always normally distributed, as long as, you know, we have this sort of second moment assumption. Okay, so then why is it important to quantify these fluctuations? Well, that's what we're going to talk about now. So we've gone a bit fast, actually, in this lecture. So let's look at the importance of the central limit theorem. So maybe let's say that, so let me maybe go into a bit of a special case maybe. So why is this, okay, so why do we care, you know, about the central limit theorem? So why is the central limit theorem fundamental for stats? So let's start with, well, let's just look at a toy problem. Toy problem, which is as follows. So we're going to be in the one-dimensional case, and we're going to assume that we have, you know, this sequence of IID random variables according to some capital P. This is on R then, as I'm just saying, with some mean. So distribution or the random variables have mean, mu naught, let's say, and variance. So we're now in one dimension, we can talk about variance. Variance sigma squared, that is of course finite. Yeah. Okay, so if we have this, then, you know, let's sort of recall from the first or second lecture what the main inferential procedures are. So these are estimation, hypothesis tests, and confidence intervals, right? So then, of course, you know, we can estimate, we're going to, but it's important, let me just say, variance known. Yeah. So I want to start with this case, known. So then if we know this sigma squared, you know, really the question here, the natural question, or at least for this toy problem, is, you know, can we estimate this mu naught, right? So we can estimate, this mu naught by the sample mean, right? And this is just from the law of large numbers, really. I mean, but of course, central limit theorem is stronger. But also, construct confidence intervals and hypothesis tests for it. Yeah. And so let's start with the confidence interval, and then we'll sort of very briefly mention the hypothesis test because it sort of follows from it. So then let me just start with the actual solution. So let Cn be the following set of real numbers, and it's an interval really. So it's the mu's such that they are away from the sample mean by no more than sigma divided by square root of n, z alpha here, square root of n, where, you know, we need to find this z alpha, where, and we can just directly define it. So, you know, we can still take, by the way, for the, maybe, yeah, just so that it doesn't get confusing, but I will just say in words, so that the probability of some capital Z being less or equal than Z alpha equals 1 minus alpha for Z being normally distributed with 0, 1, so standard normal. Yeah? Okay, so what am I saying here? Well, first of all, I just mentioned something about, you know, sort of paused in this probability measure, this double BP probability measure, so that you should imagine to be the usual PR that we were looking at with the, you know, the infinite product, with just one more product, which would be the one that defines the character set. Yeah. The distribution is this standard normal. So you, you know, by exactly the same argument, you can have one element to this infinite product. Yeah. Okay, so why to take this Cn? So given that we've gone probably a bit fast, let me pause here a bit. So why am I taking this Cn as a confidence interval? Well, this Xn bar, should be approximately like mu naught, right? So we want to look at an interval around this mu naught, you know, because then we'll be likely to sort of catch that mu naught, right? And so how large does this interval have to be, right? That's really the question. And so that's exactly where knowing, you know, the distribution of these random fluctuations is going to become handy, right? So if we understand how these guys move in some sense, you know, in a distributional sense, then we should be able to say something about creating this interval. So, you know, what do we do in this interval? Well, I mean, this is, I guess, something you've seen. So if we have a standard normal here, it's terrible drawing, but anyway, and we have here some mass alpha halves and then some other mass alpha halves here. And so therefore, you know, all of the mass there is 1 minus alpha. Then, you know, this Z alpha is going to be precisely this value that we see in there. So this would be, let's see, so this would be the Z alpha. Yeah, that would be the minus Z alpha. And right, so why do we take that one? Well, because if you look at the CN, the definition of the set, and look at the right hand side in the inequality, then you can take the square root of n to the left, and what you will get there, at least in the limit as n goes to infinity, is a normal distribution with the variance sigma squared. So then really what we are doing here is exactly accounting for that extra variance that there is in terms, you know, when compared to a standard normal. And we're looking at the quantiles of this standard normal and then saying, well, you know, if the left-hand side is approximately this normal with variance sigma squared, then this should exactly be the right quantity. Yeah. Well, at least approximately. And so then, you know, what we're going to use is some sort of asymptotic result behind it, yeah, to justify that this is indeed an asymptotic level 1 minus alpha confidence interval. Okay, so how do we go about it? Well, what we want to check is, you know, we want to study the probability and the PR of the mu naught being contained in CN, right? So we want this guy, so PR, maybe we want to be more specific than this, so let me maybe just redo here. Let me erase this PR and just write a P with the mu naught with the, so being the infinite product measure. Yeah. That's just to be very specific about this PR, yeah, so that we are under the actual mu naught, which is the true mean. Okay, so what's the probability of this belonging to this? Well, that's just simply P mu naught to the capital N, and this is going to be just simply the, so this guy minus mu naught being less or equal than sigma divided by square root of N, and just the Z alpha, right? Okay, so what we can do now, I guess, is, you know, let's write this as simply maybe, you know, let's see, so P mu naught here, and we're going to write here the square root of N of some yn hat, okay, being less or equal than z alpha, where yn, yi in this case, is going to be xi minus the mu naught divided by sigma, okay? And so, of course, the yn bar is just a sample mean of these y's, and so then what we have is that, you know, so by the central limit theorem, we get that square root of n yn hat is going to converge in distribution to what? Well, you know, the yn has mean 0 and it has variance 1. And so then, you know, this is clearly just converging to n 0, 1. Okay, that's good. And now, if we look at the absolute value, right? So the absolute value is a continuous, or maybe let me just state that for, and by the continuous mapping theorem. So remember this, I think is contained in the first part of proposition one. So continuous mapping theorem, the absolute value converges to, you know, the absolute value of this capital Z. Okay, and then, so we have that, and so now I claim, so then, the probability and the mu naught of this guy, right, so remember the right-hand side that we have it now in terms of the yn, then this is going to go precisely to the probability and the, sorry, not double b, so it's just one, the probability and the mu naught, this, of, so this is ascending goes to infinity, and this is of, of the absolute value of this capital Z, being less or equal to Z alpha, okay? And this is just by, you know, then, you know, by convergence in distribution. Why is that? Well, so what we would need is that, so because this Z alpha is a continuity point of this function, or this mapping. Okay. Why is that? Well, you know, I let you think about it, but this is just simply the probability of mu naught. So this, well, actually, you don't need this probability here. Ah, that's a bit annoying. Okay, so did we? Okay, so we won't work under the double BP actually, the whole thing. Okay, I'm sorry for that, because we want to include. We wanted to include it. So then just remember here. Okay, so let me just finish the calculation. I will talk about it in a sec. This is the Z. So this is the Z, the capital Z, being less or equal than minus Z. This. So, okay. So let me first talk about the mistake I've just made, which is that, you know, these guys really should be double P's, yeah? This double P being double P being this double P that we've got there that I mentioned, you know, is just a product of some, you know, probability, you know, this is just a product of some P and some P mu naught, this, yeah? Okay. Because then it has to include the Z as well, yeah? So the P would be the distribution of this standard normal, the law of this standard. Okay, so just to emphasize this point on continuity point, I just want to mention that, this is a continuity point. Clearly, any point in the distribution of a standard normal is a continuity point, and therefore, you know, this function here is continuous. Okay, so that's it. So then what we've shown is that, you know, this guy here is just 1 minus alpha by definition of the Z alpha. And so then, you know, that is what we just showed. So we showed that Cn is an asymptotic level 1 minus alpha confidence interval, right? Furthermore, or by this calculation. So you should check, you should convince yourselves. It's really quite immediate. By this calculation, this is the indicator of the set in which, so the indicator of the set of omegas in which the gamma belongs to Cn is a hypothesis test. Sorry, asymptotic, so let me start. Is an asymptotic level 1 minus alpha hypothesis test or for the following sort of set of hypotheses. So it's just that so the null is going to be the mu naught equals gamma, and then the alternative is just that is not. Yeah? I paused here to think because this gamma belongs to R and it's fixed, yeah. All throughout here. Yeah. Okay, so that's a very, very simple sort of check that you need to do. Yeah. Okay. So that's great, because what we've just said is simply that, knowing the distribution of the fluctuations will allow us to actually infer things about the unknown. Yeah. Okay. And so let me maybe, so what we can do, and this is maybe only applies, well, no, it doesn't only, no. So we can just say, when sigma is unknown, the same holds, it's just the same idea, replace. Okay, so the same holds, replacing this sigma by Sn, where Sn squared is defined as the sample variance with a little correction that is just to make it unbiased. And this is just as I just said, so like the sample variance. So it's this quantity here. So see example sheet. Okay. I mean, in the example sheet, I only talked about, it's only for the confidence interval, but really, I mean, if you check the hypothesis test from before, then you'll see that this is just as immediate as the other one. Yeah. Okay, so we have about 10 minutes left. So let's now then start a new section on consistency of MLE. Okay, so maybe let's start with the definition, with the actual definition of consistency, which we talked about already. So let's have the usual things. We have x1, x2, and so on. So the sample, the sequence, sorry. So this being IID copies of some capital X that is going to have from model F theta, with theta, actually let me just write distribution, B theta here, the loss. So then an estimator theta tilde, actually we didn't need the capital X in this definition. So as in they just need to be IID from such model. So this guy being an estimator from this first N observations, is we say that it is consistent if the following happens, and is that it goes to theta. You'd think, okay, but what is theta? Well, theta is precisely the parameter that is going to index the distribution or the law of these IID copies. So this is just simply saying, you know, if the true value is theta, then you should converge to the true value distribution under that sort of measure. And this has to happen, of course, for all elements. So remember, we want this sort of uniformity in statistics because we don't, you know, we cannot access the parameter itself. That's the quantity of interest, and so any statement should apply to every single possibility that there is. Yeah. Okay. So we may write, by the way, let me just state here. So we may write the following, so for this consistency, we may just simply write theta n, sorry, tilde going to, my bad. So I should have written here the infinite product measure. Yeah. So, but we may just drop the natural numbers. That's what I just want to say now, or just simply say this. Yeah. And it's understood that the convergence is in probability and under the right probability measure. Yeah. Okay. So let me introduce the assumptions for the consistency of MLE. So assumption maybe A, we're going to call it. And so we're going to, so this is an assumption on the model. And so let this guy, well, the assumption is that this guy is a, so is, so this is a statistical model that is going to statistical model, yeah, of PMFs or PDFs. And again, we are working on, you know, RD. And we are going to assume the following things. So maybe let me jump to the next line. So we have, first of all, not line, sorry, page. So then the first one is going to be that this is larger than zero for all X in the calligraphic space of X and for all theta in the parameter space. Okay, so what is this saying? Well, it's sort of saying like, you know, the support. So for every theta, for every different parameter, the PMFs or the PDFs should have the calligraphic X as part of their support. Okay, so it's not really saying that it has to be the whole of the support, but it's just that. Yeah. And so now this second condition is precisely going to enforce a bit more than that. So we're going to say that, so we want, in the case of a PMF, we wish this guy to be, you know, one, or, you know, in the case of a PDF, then we wish this guy to be exactly one. Yeah. And this is for all theta as well. So you'll be thinking, okay, but this is stupid because, I mean, you suppose any PMF and PDF should, in, you know, sum up or integrate to one, indeed. But what this is saying is that it will do so only over, as in, it will do so over the whole calligraphic X. And so then what we really have here is that, you know, like a support condition. So what this is saying is that they have common support for all theta. Okay, so remember that we were saying that the support has to be has to contain this calligraphic X. And so if, of course, you have all of the mass there, then you know it has to be, that has to be the support. So it's basically saying that they all have the same support. Now that is wrong. So if you go into probability measure, you will see that this is, you know, this is up to null sets, right? So up to sets of probability zero. And so really the meaning of this is common support almost surely, yeah, under whatever measure we're considering here. Okay. So yeah, some sort of common dominating measure, if you like. Okay, so now let's introduce the rest of the assumptions. So now we have three. It's a bit long. So three, what's the third one? So we want, you know, remember when I was talking about the intuition behind, you know, the type of results we wanted to prove, then we sort of wanted to have some continuity of this guy, yeah, for all theta in here. So you can go back to it and just check the discussions I gave you for that. Okay, so we have continuity. What's another thing that we may wish to have, generally speaking, and that we will? So we want this guy, sorry, let me just put this, the whole sample space, to be contained in P. But the really the assumption is that this is compact. Yeah. So what are we going to get if we have a continuous function that is compact? Then you attain the maximum, yeah, or the minimum in that set. So that's going to guarantee basically existence of the MLE. And now uniqueness, what do we need? Well, we already sort of spoke about it in the first or second lecture. So we want identifiability. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so these three give us existence and uniqueness. Yeah. We're not talking about correctly specified, because we're not really talking about random variable here. Yeah, we're just talking about statistical model. And so we're talking then about identifiability as just a property of the statistical model. Yes. Okay, and the last one is going to be, so something that we nearly sort of introduced in this form, but it is a bit stronger, and is that we want the supremum over the parameter space of this log of the PDF or PMF to be finite. Yeah. So remember, I mean, so what we assumed, I think for observation one, was that, you know, it was the same assumption but without the supremum. And that was fine at that point, because we were just talking about intuition. But what we are going to get from this, so this will guarantee or will guarantee that the continuity that we assumed in three holds for this other function that is the, you know, the expectation of the one above, yeah, the log. So this is really the quantity that we wanted to control, if you remember. Okay, so to transfer it to the expectation and not only the actual logarithm, then we'll need the dominated convergence here. Yeah. Convergence. Okay, so we'll talk about this in the next lecture, in which we're going to introduce directly the consistency of MLE and we'll prove it. Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed this lecture and I'll see you again on Wednesday.